All right, so let's explore these kinematic variables a little bit more and their relationship. So we have displacement, which is your movement, represented here by x. Then you have velocity, which is the change in displacement over time, so how fast you're going. And then you have acceleration. Are you speeding up or slowing down? And that's the change in velocity over the change in time. So let's look at more detail in velocity. So your average velocity would just take the starting point minus the final point over the time it took you to move that distance, and you would get your answer, and the units are meters per second. Okay, it's the slope, rise over run, if you remember way back to trigonometry, of the position versus time graph, right? So we have position in meters over time in seconds. So let's look, this is a graph of somebody walking. And so you should be able to look at this and then recreate what they're actually doing physically. So they start at zero, and at the end of this A segment, they move 6 meters in 6 seconds. So they have moved 1 meter per second in a certain direction, and it's at a constant. That's the average velocity, and it's at a constant pace. So what happens in B here? Okay, the time is still moving forward, so you're going from 6 seconds to 10 seconds, but have they changed their position? And the answer is no. They are still at 6 meters. So basically, they walked 6 meters, and during the time segment of B, they're just standing there. Okay, then they go in the opposite direction for C. They go from 6 meters back to 2 meters, and it took them from 10 seconds to 18 seconds. So they walk back a little bit more slowly. And then all of a sudden, D looks very interesting, right? It's not linear anymore. And so what's happening with this? If we take the slopes of all these little mini segments, they go from flatter, a little bit more steep, and then over here they get really steep. So basically this is somebody starting to walk slowly and then run up to the position of 14 meters. So here they're in, say, with a positive direction, they're walking, constant rate, stand, turn around, walk back slowly, and then turn around and start slowly and then speed right up. So I think it's pretty cool that you could look at a line graph and then basically tell a story of what the person's actually doing, or even video idea here, have this line graph or a similar line graph up and have an image of the person actually doing what the graph is showing you. All right, just another view of different linear velocities. So you have displacement over time. So this slope is a little less steep. So this person is going slower than this person, right? Because they have a steeper, they've gone the same amount of distance in less of a period of time. If you go the same distance in less time, you go faster. And then you have this nonlinear velocity where the slope is constantly changing. And so it's slower here, and then your velocity speeds up. Okay, so that's velocity. So let's look at results from a race. So here I have the x, distance in miles. So this tells you it was a 10-mile race, and time up to 100 minutes. Right? So a little over an hour and a half. Okay, so I took 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 participants. Female 45, male 29, female 26, female 75, and a male 62. It's the beauty of road races, right? All kinds of genders and huge age range. And from the data that they report on the race, I was able to plot at 3 miles what their times were, 5 miles, 7 miles, and 10 miles. And this is the plot. And so my questions are, who won the race? And to follow that up, how do you know this? All right, typically whoever ran the race ran the 10 miles, which everybody did, but in the shortest amount of time. Okay, so the 29-year-old male ran 10 miles in the quickest time, so they won the race. All right, who was the slowest? Okay, so you can look at these and you say, ooh, this blue one, they slowed down. But lo and behold, the slowest runner would be the person that ran the 10 miles in the longest period of time. And that would be the pink dots or the female that's 75 years old. Define the slope of a line and what it tells you about the speed. So basically the slope of the distance versus time graph is the velocity. So you can look at the overall velocity, this person's faster versus the 75-year-old female, or you can look at each segment and figure out who is faster, or more importantly, who is speeding up and who is slowing down. And that could have implications on how you would train these runners if they were to hire you. All right, a different way to look at the velocity for this race. I calculated the velocity for between miles 1 and 3, 3 and 5, 5 and 7, and 7 and 10. And so this is for 45-year-old female, 29-year-old male, 26-year-old female, 75-year-old female, and the male who is 62. So my questions, who slowed down the most in the second half of the race? So who slowed down, that would mean whose velocity decreased in the second half of the race. When I'm looking at the second half of the race, I'd probably look at the green and yellow. So I'm looking for drops in the green and yellow. And basically the 45-year-old female tanked at the end. Basically her velocity really dropped off. This male 29 also had a drop off, but he was a bit of a yo-yo runner, right? So he's running fast, slow down, fast, slow down. 26-year-old female kind of slowed down at the end as well. This 75-year-old female, she was solid the entire race. And the 62-year-old male slowed down and then may have realized, oh my gosh, I'm 3 miles from the end, and sped up again. Or maybe stopped to take pictures with his family. Maybe stopped for a porta potty stop. Who knows what could have happened there. Got a cramp and resolved it, etc. Does this data tell you anything about why the first place runner won? The first place was the male 29, overall highest velocity. And that was interesting. They had an interesting strategy. May have been out in front, slowed down, maybe heard somebody coming up behind them, sped up, slowed down. So was this mental? Was this physiologic? This change in velocity? That would need a bit more analysis. All right, and then we can look at the accelerations. So for acceleration, it's the change in velocity over time. So you take the differences between these two velocities over the time, between green and pink, and then yellow and green, and you can get this type of graph. So the acceleration between miles 3 and 5, 7 and 5, 10 and 7. Okay? And so this can also tell you a story. Did the participants accelerate during the race? Explain. Well, yes, they did. Some accelerated in the positive direction, and some accelerated in the negative direction. Those that accelerated in the positive direction were going faster, and those that accelerated in the negative direction were slowing down. So you can see the 45-year-old female accelerated in the beginning and then just kept slowing down the entire race. Here you have the male 29. So this is between the first velocity and the second velocity. He did slow down. You can see from between blue and pink. So he decelerated or slowed down. Then he accelerated and then he slowed down again. Female 26 had some slowing down, but not as much as the, not as erratic, if you will, as the male 29. This female 75, she was consistent the entire way, so no acceleration changes. And the male 62 slowed down and then at the end said, whoop, I'm going to catch up. And so this is me. And so my last question is, do you need more kinematic data to train Vanessa to run a better race next year? And so what you need to first look at this data and say, why is she slowing down? Was she untrained? Was she trained only for, say, a 5-mile race and then really tanked? Did something happen? Was there an injury? Was there, you know, GI problems, right? Long races. It depends how you fuel yourself. So you can come up with all kinds of hypotheses of what could have happened. And then you would talk to your runner and figure out if you could come up with a training strategy. So just knowing the speed of the race and breaking it down to get the speed during different time points, it could be a huge amount of data to kind of come up with a training program individualized for someone. Okay, so let's continue to look at the relationship between velocities and accelerations. Acceleration is almost like a push. Something's either pushing you forward or pushing you backwards or slowing you down. And you can think of it kind of like a force or a push because F equals ma. And m is your mass, so force and acceleration are directly related. So one of the questions I like to ask students is, are the terms deceleration and negative acceleration the same? Deceleration and negative acceleration. Okay, and then I'm just going to walk you through this diagram of this person going through this oval. So on one side, we have west and east. So those are directions. Or you can call those same directions negative and positive. All right, just directions. So as we go from A to B, the car has to accelerate in the positive direction. So you get a positive acceleration, which increases the positive velocity. So they speed up. About halfway, they brake, so they are hit with a negative acceleration, right? It's slowing them down in the positive direction. Their velocity, their positive velocity slows down, and then they stop. And they turn the corner. To speed up in the negative direction, you need a negative acceleration. That is increasing your velocity in the negative direction. Halfway, you brake, and you slow down from a positive acceleration, pushing you back, which slows down your negative velocity. Phew, that is a lot. It is complicated, and we're going to go over it face-to-face as well. But basically, in this direction from A to B, deceleration is negative acceleration. When you go from the positive direction to the negative direction, deceleration is not the same as negative acceleration. And the key to this, so start to think about this, is that negative is just a direction. All right, just a different visual. I don't know if this will help or hurt, but the happy